Good evening, and thank you all so much for being here, sharing this evening with us. For some of you, this may be your first time here, and I'll just take a brief moment to explain what it is that you are experiencing. Magic. So what we do is, sometime in late April, early May, we put out a call for people from all over the Central New York area who might be interested in coming together with one common interest, and that is tackling some of the great masterworks of orchestral repertoire. And it's been going on for 46 years, as you can see, and you know, my predecessors carried on this tradition for many decades. This is my 18th season with this group, and it is one of the highlights of my year, coming together with this fabulous group of people. Now, some of you know that this fabulous group of people is disparate and not necessarily an ongoing endeavor communicating one with another every day or every week or even every month. For many of these people, it's actually just once a year that they come together to get to see each other and to make music, and that's here with the Summer Festival Orchestra. We have doctors and lawyers, we have real estate agents, we have captains of industry, we have politicians, we have teachers, both retired and currently teaching. We have students, both at the college level and at the high school level. We have spouses and family members that come together to make this group happen. And we do it in four rehearsals. And so people, you know, ask me every year, you know, how is it possible that you guys do Tchaikovsky and Rimsky-Korsakov and Dvorak and, you know, Stravinsky? We've done so much music over the last 18 years. It's truly remarkable, the repertoire that this group has tackled. And what I have to say is that this group comes to the stage every rehearsal hungry to play music, because it might not be something they get to do every day. Whether you're if you're a teacher or not, this level of literature might not be something that you tackle every day. And so it really gives you a chance to feed that inner artist, that inner musician that's in you. And if you're not a musician by trade, if you're not a teacher or a student in a school of music or in a high school or a secondary area, you don't get a chance to do this very often at all. And so this is a real opportunity for them to really stretch their wings and to flex their musical muscles and to remember what it was to be a musician in college, and then to go out into the real world and make a living and to support the culture and the community that we see each day. But then they get a chance to do this, and it's really truly remarkable. It's enriching for me, and I think it's enriching for the ensemble. The other day we were having a chat about what this ensemble means to me, and to me, as the conductor, it is a group that inspires joy in me and in each other. And no matter what music we're tackling, whether it's white knuckle music, you know, really difficult, high-level music, or whether it's popular-esque music like tonight. And so what you're going to face this evening, what you're going to hear this evening, is a group that is flexing its muscle in a little different way, and that is by tackling a night of Spanish popular music. That opening three numbers from Carmen, from the suite number one, from the opera Carmen, certainly they don't really need any introduction at all. That's why I just came out and conducted the prelude and the Aragonese and then the March of the Toreadors. Since 1875, some of the most popular music ever written. And Bizet influenced many people to come after him and around that same time. And so we're tonight going to hear the music of Manuel de Falla, who in 1905 wrote the Spanish dance number one from La Vida Breve, which is a life is short, which is next. And then you're going to hear El Choclo, which is a tango, and we'll talk a little bit more about that after the Falla. But Villoldo, Argentine composer, probably, if not the most famous tango, right at the very top of the tango list of popular tango numbers. And then closing with Rimsky-Korsakov, who in 1888 wrote the Capriccio Espanol. We'll talk about that in a little more detail later. But this group is remarkable and spectacular and unique, I think, in the Central New York area, in that it comes together from disparate corners and makes things happen like magic. And that's what it feels like to me, and that's what I think it feels like to them. And so we appreciate you being here sharing in this. I want to thank the town of Camillus and Mary Ann Coogan and Eric Bacon from Parks and Recreation for making this possible, helping us to preserve this fabulous space. And I thank Bill Mercer for being our faculty sponsor and host for this, and for helping to make that possible. college this summer and off traveling, isn't joining us tonight, but he's a major part of why we're here and how we're able to make this happen. So again, thank you to them. This next piece by Manuel de Falla, from his opera La Vie de Rêve, is the Spanish Dance Number 1. And feel free to tap along, and if you want to get up out of your seat and dance along a little bit, that's just fine. It's certainly a perfect piece for that. And for those of you who are tango specialists, when the tango comes up, you're welcome to come up here and use as much of this floor as you'd like. So, all right. So this is Manuel de Falla's Spanish Dance Number 1.
Thank you.
My name is James Tapia. My day job is Director of Orchestral Activities at Syracuse University. I've been there 18 years. It's the joy of my life, getting a chance to work with young musicians and with fantastic colleagues, many of whom are here on the stage with me tonight. And so, Summer Festival Orchestra has run through the University College for years, and then made some shifts outside of the School of Music and into the community. And like I said to you a little bit earlier, the town of Camillus was gracious enough to help take us on and to bring us into this fabulous facility. So that's who I am, and that's what we do. The next piece has a unique quality to it, and that would be called saxophones. And so for those of you who look at an orchestra as an ensemble that perhaps doesn't include saxophones, accordion, keyboard instruments, harmonica, things of that nature, in Argentine, that tradition is not convention. And so when Violdo wrote this piece, it was for actually a mixed ensemble that he himself was a guitarist and sometimes would add a harmonica player or a squeeze box player along with him, even a harpist that was a friend of his, that they would go and they would play in this establishment, I'll just call it that. And so he wrote many works that became quite popular around the turn of the century, and this piece, El Choclo, is like I said before, one of the most famous tangos today. And part of that is that in the 1950s and 60s, there were several renditions of this called The Kiss of Fire, that the words were changed, the melody was the same, but it was recorded by Louis Armstrong. That's the first time I heard it, and several other artists that actually made it a number one hit. So the theme is very familiar, and it might be familiar to many of you, but the original of this was a song, a dance, about the life of the tango artist and these establishments in which they would go to dance. And in this particular instance, the owner of the establishment was I think the word that I should probably use is thug. He was the establishment owner, but he was also quite nefarious and infamous in the town. And the thing that was unique about him was that he was blonde-haired and blue-eyed. And so El Choclo, the translation of it is, the corn cob is actually referring to the color of his hair and the color of his skin. And so there is a song about him as well, sort of a hidden subtext song by Lolo that we don't actually, we don't use that because it's a little bawdy, is the way that I would describe it. And so, so what we get here tonight is the theme material and its variation, full orchestra including saxophones, percussion, and one of the most famous of the tango works out there by Angel Violdo. This is El Choclo. movement to have happen back there. We have the percussion around, we get the saxophones back over the percussion section, because they're doing triple duty tonight, playing saxophone beautifully, by the way. Thank you, gentlemen. And they're also helping in the percussion section, so they're multifaceted musicians. I mentioned earlier that one of the things that we do is we approach masterworks with this orchestra every year. And I mentioned that last year we did Czech 5, we've done Dvorak 9, Dvorak 8, Brahms 1, Brahms 2, Stravinsky, Rite of Spring. Gosh, you name it, we've done all sorts of things with this group, and it's a pleasure to work with them on, you know, heavy repertoire with this orchestra. Now, this piece isn't heavy in that way as far as the theme material is concerned. It's heavy in that it's one of the most popular works from this era. The Capriccio Espanol is one of three top works by Rimsky-Korsakov. The Capriccio Espanol, Scheherazade, certainly Russian Easter Overture, sort of big works on his repertoire list that orchestras play every year, hundreds of performances every year by professional orchestras and collegiate orchestras around the world. So, Maggie Mercer, lovely lady here, I'm playing concertmaster. When we were talking about repertoire, she said, "I want one with a lot of notes." And I said, "Okay." And so we did. We picked this one. This has a lot of notes. And it is a fantastic work in that it describes from a different perspective, as Bizet did, sort of from a French perspective, Giotto from the Argentinian perspective, Defaya from the Spanish true perspective on a Spanish dance. And then we have Rimsky-Korsakov, who tackles this Spanish concept from his nationalistic background. And so, as a Russian national, he really extends himself. And originally he wrote this as a violin solo with an orchestral accompaniment. And then decided as he was getting into it that no, this really should be a tour de force concerto for orchestra. And that's what it becomes. If you ever encounter this, you hear this in the PBS or any of the local radio stations or even online, you may hear people say something like, "Well, it's a beautifully orchestrated work." That's correct, but that really undercuts the musicianship of it and the masterful craft and technique that went into it, as well as the deep connection outside of his own comfort zone for music that would not have been in his bailiwick, as it wouldn't have been in his daily activities. So we have the alboradas, which are morning songs, played in Spain at the coffee shops with tambourines, tambourining, and castanets, and all of the strings playing with this fantastic, flourishing, virtuosic technique. You'll hear a clarinet soloist, you'll hear a violin soloist, you'll hear a flute soloist. And the orchestra really begins to shine as unique entities with each of the pieces. The second movement is a set of five variations, so you'll see those variations. And those five variations are referred to then in the gypsy song that we hear, number 4. And then we finish up again with a big flourish of the alborada and the variation music all tied together. So it is absolutely brilliant music. Korsakov did a fantastic job bringing unique quality to the music and making it something timeless, as it were. And so we hope you enjoy our final piece on the concert this evening, the Capriccio Espanol of Rimsky-Korsakov, featuring all of the virtuosos here in this orchestra. Thank you very much for being here. We enjoyed having you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.